the book I just published is titled Resigned Activism, and it's about daily lives of people who live in polluted villages across three different places in rural China. What I'm trying to explain in the book is that when we think about activism, we shouldn't only think about the conventional forms of activism like protests, petitions, or lawsuits, but also think about the more invisible, perhaps, ways in which people engage with pollution in their daily lives. So protecting yourself, wearing a mask, closing the windows, drinking bottled water, and when it seems possible, escalating on a more collective level, but basically shifting between various modes of action. So I think there are several lessons here for those of us interested in environmentalism and in activism more broadly, not just in China, but also elsewhere, because it's about paying more attention to the subtle ways in which people interact with their daily challenges of living with pollution, the ways in which they might protect themselves, but also the ways in which they might resign themselves to the status quo. And to me, activism also always has to be understood in that framework, thinking about how people become aware of the problems that they face, of the threats that they face, but also their sense of the limits to their own agency. What are they, in fact, capable of achieving if they take action, and what is beyond their reach? And that, to me, is just a general point about agency for us all to think about. So for this book, I went to three separate sites, which have different types of pollution, but comparable in terms of how severe it was and in terms of how the population reacted to the pollution. So the first site I worked in was a fertilizer plant site, also with phosphorus mining that is used in the fertilizer production. And I worked in that village with a team of researchers from China from a variety of disciplines, and we tried to understand what it's like to live in this place for the local population, also for the migrant population that gravitates to the site in search of work. So we're talking about people who sometimes suffer with nosebleeds, with sore throats, with sore joints, swollen joints, which are potentially correlated to the types of pollution that characterize this area. The second site was a lead zinc mine, and here I worked with a separate team, but also an interdisciplinary team. So the effects on health were different. They ranged more around nervous system effects. Mental capacity for children was impaired. There were cardiovascular diseases, there were respiratory system diseases. And here we had quite a substantial amount of data collected on the types of pollution present and on the levels of exposure. So my job, together with other social scientists, was again to find out what the population knew about it and what they did about it over time. In the third site, I worked in a town which is quite notorious globally. It's called Guiyu, and it's known as a center for dismantling of electronic waste. So things like mobile phones, laptops, washing machines. And for the most part, this can be done relatively harmlessly if it's using simply mechanical techniques to dismantle items. But in some cases, for instance, to extract heavy metals from or precious metals from circuit boards, it involves melting plastic, it involves using acids, which can affect the environment nearby and also people's health.